O Hindus, of all the vices and weaknesses which have brought about thy fall, the greatest and most potent are thy virtues. Swatantryaveer Sawarkar calls these virtues as perverted and elaborates his view in this book. Six golden pages in the history of Bharat, written by him and translated and condensed by myself. Namaskar. This book is a revelation, not only because of the untold history, but also because of the unique perspective it presents. Even today, with great pride, we state the examples of Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, Chimaji Appa, Rana Pratap, who respectfully sent back the daughters-in-law who were left behind after defeating the enemy. Sawarkar says, O kings, the fearful screams and the pitiable lamentations of our own abducted daughters, which were reverberating all through the nation, didn't they reach your ears? They must be saying, don't you forget the atrocities suffered by us. Let the Muslims take a fright that if Hindus were victorious, our molestation shall be avenged. Only then the Muslims will dare not indulge in such depravities, and lakhs of Hindu women could have been saved from suffering indignities. For such chivalrous behavior had no change of heart in the Muslims. In fact, they held Hindu chivalry to ridicule. If indeed the Hindus were so chivalrous, the first right to their chivalry would have been of their own women, their wives, their daughters, their sisters, whom we have abducted, raped and enslaved for centuries, and yet none came to rescue them. If at all they don't even touch our women, it is only due to fear of retribution. The Muslim women too were not left behind in the harassment of the Hindu women. They enticed Hindu girls in their neighborhoods, locked them up, beat them up, and conveyed them to Muslim centers like mosques. They were taught that it was their religious duty. In pre-Islamic era, there was not such a foolish interpretation of chivalry. If a snake charges to bite, it has to be killed, whether it be a male or a female. Tratika, a she-demon, had destroyed many yajna fires and even killed some rishis. When she attacked Rama, who was protecting the rishis, Rama killed her instantly. Shurpanakha, when she advanced towards Sita to eat her up like a tender cucumber, Lakshmana chopped off her nose at that very instant and sent her back, not with gifts and with respect to show off his chivalry. On the net, I was shocked to see comments like how a Hindu icon advocated rape as a political weapon, or his followers who chant the name of Rama seem to be unaware that Sawarkar himself believed in Ravan Dharma, etc. Rape as a political weapon was actually used by the Muslims, whereby they could improve their numerical population and thus their political traction. Rape, abduction of Hindu women was adopted as a policy for which Muslims were bestowed with titles like Ghazi. Has Swatantryaveer Sawarkar expressly stated that the enemy women should be raped? No. All he says is that fiendish strategy cannot be countered by noble or ethical strategy, but only by savai fiendish strategy or super fiendish strategy. That atrocities have to be avenged so that such crimes are stopped. Or that Muslim women too deserve punishment as accomplices in the crime. Has Sawarkar given any reason for such misinterpretation from his conduct or otherwise? Women such as Madam Kama, who are involved along with him in the freedom struggle, had utmost respect for him and vice versa. His empathy towards women is evident in his life and in his writings. Veer Sawarkar only wanted to awaken Hindus and cure them of perverted perception of virtues, which sadly exist even today. After the TMC victory in the Bengal assembly elections, everybody was saddened, enraged as the co-religionists of Ghori and Ghazni celebrated their victory by looting, killing, raping Hindus. And the Hindu leaders made statements like how benevolently Hindus behave even in victory, etc., still showing off Hindu chivalry. Nothing seems to have learnt from history. Well, coming back to the book, the contents of the book, Narkasura carried away 16,000 Bharatiyan women to his Asur kingdom or Assyria of today. Sri Krishna, along with his army, attacked his Asura kingdom, killed Narkasura, and rescued all the captivated women. He did not forsake them to the Assyrians for being forcibly violated and thus defiled. As the Bhupati, or the Lord of the Earth, he took on the responsibility of providing for them, of protecting them, of rehabilitating them so that they are respectfully accepted back into society. Later, with overtones of deification, it got distorted to as if Sri Krishna became the pati of all these women, or he married all these women. What did the Marathas do after winning the war against Tipu Sultan? It must have been only a few months since Tipu's men had carried away lakhs of Hindu men and women after winning a battle. These Hindu men and women, enslaved by their Muslim captors, must have been elated when they heard the victorious cries of the approaching Maratha armies. They must have rushed to the windows and to the slits of the doors and thought that finally our saviors have arrived. Amongst the returning soldiers, they must have spotted their neighbors, their relatives, even their own husbands, sons, brothers. But just as pompously as the Maratha armies entered the towns and villages, they left gloriously and with victorious cries, with not even an acknowledgement of these enslaved Hindus. They rescued none. It occurred to none, neither the Chhatrapati, nor the Peshwas, nor the noble Sardars, or even the Shankaracharyas. Nobody felt ashamed of leaving behind their brothers and sisters. And one can imagine the dejection felt by these Hindus, who must have resigned to a life of slavery and misery. It was the perverse belief of defilement, due to which a Hindu, by mere association with a Muslim or a Christian, was considered to be defiled and converted. And once converted, always remained so. There was no way of coming back into the Hindu fold. This was the ban on reconversion. In pre-Islamic times, or even early Islamic invasions, there was not such a foolish belief of defilement. Chandragupta Maurya had married Helena, the daughter of the defeated Greek general Seleucus. And Bappa Rawal had married the princess of the vanquished Muslims. She lived along with the other queens in the ladies' chambers, and his sons from her were accepted as being born in the clan of the Surya Vamshi. Unlike the foolish religiosity of the Marathas, who would not accept the brave Bajirao Peshwa's son from Mastani, a half-Muslim, in spite of Bajirao's wishes, and thus the child was pushed into Muslim society. During the times of Shakas and Hunas, not only the nobility, but even the common citizens unhesitatingly married the foreign women. Thus the absorption of not only these women and their children, but entire foreign communities into our own religion and culture was possible. As the valiance of the nation, the capacity to digest, or the potence of the nation, was still intact. There's not a single person remains in Bharat today who will say that, yes, I am that Shaka, or I am that Huna who had invaded Bharat. Another example of perverse or foolish interpretation of virtues we all know is of Prithviraj Chauhan, who, after having defeated Mohammed Ghori in battle and captivated him alive, let him go free along with his army, with only a promise of not attacking Bharat again. Kshama Virasya Bhushanam, or forgiveness as an ornament of the brave, is prescribed for an equally magnanimous enemy. Ethics, even on the battlefield, are relevant if both the parties follow them, like in Mahabharat. But the Hindus of those times had forgotten the teachings of Bhagavad Gita. The due consideration has to be given to the propriety of time, place, and person. Thus, they kept countering the fiendish war strategy of the Muslims with basically noble or sattvic ethics, which, when untimely applied, proved disastrous. The Rajputs, more proud of their suicidal generosity than having defeated the enemy, smugly returned back to Delhi and celebrated their victory. And what did Mohammed Ghori do? With gratitude to Prithviraj Chauhan, did he depart from his enmity? No. According to his religious precepts, like a serpent instigated by injury, he again attacked Prithviraj Chauhan with even more vehemence. Virtues such as tolerance, forgiveness, generosity are fed to the Hindu child along with his mother's milk. But the essence of it is rarely explained. To tolerate marauders like Ghori and Ghazni, who considered it their religious duty to rout the Hindu faith and even to celebrate their accession to the throne, massacred Hindus en masse, was not tolerance towards another religion. It was tolerance of irreligion. It was not even tolerance. It was impotence. But due to the perverse interpretation of virtues, foolish beliefs like defilement and bans on reconversion, etc., the Hindus of those times did not realize it. Thus, it was no wonder that it caused immense numerical loss to the Hindu nation. The real surprise would be how still so many of us remain Hindus. This has to be attributed to the military or the political victory of the Hindus on the battlefield, and also to the several brave men who emerged, although intermittently, and guided the otherwise blinded Hindu society. To give a few examples, Rawat Chechak of Jaisalmer married the daughter of Sultan Haibat Khan. He named her Somal Devi and assimilated her into his Yadav clan. Kaur Jagmal of Marwar, after defeating the Shah of Gujarat, he married his beautiful daughter Gidoli. His children from her were accepted amongst the nobility of Marwar. Raimal, the king of Marwar, captured 600 Muslim women. And Rana Kumbha, he carried away all the captivated Muslim women to his kingdom, reconverted them, and married them off according to their social status. Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, he reconverted Netaji Palkar and others, and in order to facilitate their acceptance back into society, he gave away his own daughter in marriage to Netaji Palkar's son. Raja Jayasthiti of Nepal made it so difficult for the Muslims that they were driven out. He held mass reconversion ceremonies for the unfortunate Hindus who were coerced into conversion. When Arundhati Rai of Ajmer conquered the Muslims, he performed a grand yajna and built a temple at the same place. He also built a lake called Anasagar. Anyone who is wanting to come back into fold simply had to bathe in this lake with due declaration of his intent, and he was supposed to be considered pure and accepted back. Maharaja Amar Singh of Jaisalmer built the Amarsagar lake for the same purpose. And lakhs of Hindus came back into the fold in the Sindh. And the Hindu religious authorities acknowledged the same by granting certificates. Under the leadership of the powerful Maharana Jaswant Singh of Jodhpur and the brave Durgadas Rathod, they demolished not only the mosques built over Hindu temples, but all the mosques. They converted not only the neo-Muslimized Hindus, but as many Muslims as possible. If the Muslims went on throwing beef into Hindu temples and wells, they passed pork in the Muslim mosques and paid them in the same coin. Not many of us might have heard of Maharshi Deval and Acharya Medhatithi, who brought religious revolution in about 900 to 1000 CE. Maharshi Deval declared that the ban on reconversion itself was irreligious and unlawful in those exigent times. In his Deval's Prati, he states that if within a prescribed period, say about a year, if a convert wants to come back into the Hindu fold, with an atonement of something as simple as a fast, he was supposed to be considered pure and accepted back. The liberal attitude towards women is particularly laudable considering those times. After her next menstrual cycle, the woman was to be considered pure and accepted back. Even women impregnated due to rapes were to be considered pure after the delivery of the fetus. Sadly and surprisingly though, he did not make any such provision for the children born out of Muslim seed. Perhaps the society of those times was not ready for such a revolutionary reform. How many of us have heard of Khusro Khan? Khusro Khan, a Hindu hero, an important figure for Hindu history. Even academicians and historians may not have a complete idea of his revolution, which converted the Muslim Sultanate to a Hindu Samrajya, the Muslim Takht to a Hindu Simhasan, overnight, as if with a magic wand. It was Khusro Khan who was a source of inspiration for Hariharan Bukka, who later founded the Vijayanagar Empire. Hariharan Bukka were carried away in their youth to Delhi and forcefully converted to Islam. At the first opportunity, they returned back to the Deccan, and the visionary Vidyaranya Swami proficient in both political and religious precepts, reconverted them and others who were willing to come back into the Hindu fold. It must be Khusro Khan's revolution which was inspiration for Hemchandra or Emperor Hemu, and perhaps even Shahaji and Sambhaji. Another question which must have rattled many of us is, why is there a Muslim majority in East Bengal? Delhi, which was ruled by bigoted emperors for over 500 years, maintained a Hindu majority then and even today. Uttar Pradesh, right up to West Bengal, maintains a Hindu majority, but only in East Bengal, the Hindus are reduced to a minority. Sawarkar says, on adopting Buddhism, if Ashoka had abdicated his throne, become a monk and preached the Buddhist principles moving from place to place, like the Shakya Muni or Gautam Buddha, who had relinquished his Shakya throne, it wouldn't have been so disastrous to the national cause. But Ashoka, he used state machinery to impose Buddhism. The lads who entered Buddhist monkhood were provided with free clothing, free food, free bedding in the Buddhist viharas or the monasteries built by Ashoka, mainly at the expense of the Vedic exchequer. Many of these might have entered monkhood only to escape the daily grind of life. And it was preached in these monasteries that practicing non-violence or renouncing family life was greater and holier than the brave soldier who laid down his life for the freedom of his nation. Thus the Buddhists became pacifists, and when the Muslims attacked, some might have preferred to die rather than convert. Some picked up their religious texts and fled to Tibet and China. But not one fought. There is no evidence of any Buddhist army or a Buddhist organization which resisted the Muslim onslaught. East Bengal, due to its proximity to the Ashokan capital of Pataliputra, had a majority Buddhist population, which with the exceptions of few, all converted to Islam. Now, could you have linked the tragic partition of India in 1947 to an event that occurred more than 2000 years ago when Ashoka spread Buddhism by using state powers? With several such insights over many triumphs and travails, Veer Sawarkar takes a review of history right from the times of Alexander's invasion to finally when the British left India. Covering the struggles of our brave heroes who not for a moment let the conquerors rest on their laurels, who fought tenaciously and valiantly until Swarajya or independence was re-established. These glorious epochs have been referred to as the golden pages in the history of Bharat and have been condensed into only 200 pages in this book, which I urge you all to read. Sawarkar was a great bhakt of Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. He had composed several poems and even an aarti in praise of Shivaji. His play called Sanyasta Khadga or The Ascetic Spear is supposed to be inspired by Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. And hence we conclude this talk with a verse from one of his poems, which says, ती शुद्धि हेतुची कर्मी राहुदे, ती बुद्धि भावड्या जीवा लाभुदे, ती शक्ति शोणिता माजी वाहुदे. नमस्कार.
Namaste to everyone. Thank you very much, Ms. Vaishali, for an interesting talk, though brief. We got to know many, many facts which have not been taught to us in history books. I myself did not know that, you know, even Rajput kings had done this conversion back to, you know, of the people whom they had taken
yes.
back to Hinduism. So it's like really, really interesting. Mm-hmm. I remember Sangam talks at that time Shrijan talks, what it was called earlier, had organized a talk by Ms. Shefali Vaidya on the whole subject of the Goan Inquisition and so on, mm-hmm. during which I had asked her, why was it not possible? They were all forced converts, basically, including many Brahmins who converted to Christianity, to Catholicism rather, that why wasn't there an attempt after independence to bring them back? So she just said that there were so many problems, you know, with regard to being seen as pure, not being seen as pure, and those kind of factors, that somehow that never happened. They remained as that after converting. Whereas what you have mentioned here is that the kings were actually able to do it. The respective kings that you. So where do you think the insights that you have got now and working on this book and all this research, how do you think that can help inform a strategy or a policy for Indian government in this regard?
I can say a few things that Sawarkar has said. Enemy has never been pliable enough until he was, defeated by the sword. In those days, it was sword. In today's times, it should be something else. He also cautions many a times in the books that what I am talking about is of those days, and the same principles cannot be applied today. If for any person to be pliable enough to be assimilated into your religion, your culture, the physical might or some kind of compulsion is necessary, he says. Which war has been won without a struggle?
Do you think if there are people in the government who notice your book, I'm not asking another question, can we help create a policy, through advisors like yourself, through anyone who is to get this done? If those who, there are many people who do want to do ghar vapsi, as it's called.
Yeah.
But
I think if there have been examples when the Kashmiri Pandits wanted to come back, then recently I heard, and then that king, he approached the priests of prince of Varanasi, and they said, no, it is not possible. So such a foolishness should not be done. If somebody is willing to come back, he should be brought back respectably and respectfully and lovingly, not with the, something like you all are the cowards who had got converted, you all got afraid, and then you all preferred to convert rather than die, and such things should not be said. They should be accepted back with respect and love. That is what I feel. And many people are still doing it, I think. Even Arya Samaj has been doing it right from the beginning.
Namaste, Vaishali ji. You have given several examples from the past. Are they all present in the book that you have written, and how can we put it in the public discourse?
Except for one example of Shivaji Maharaj, all the examples are from the book. In fact, I have left out a few examples because I wanted the talk to be only of about 15 to 20 minutes. And how do we get them into the public domain? I think 2-3 minutes, 5 minutes shorts, or some notes or something which can be circulated on Twitter, WhatsApp, and things like that. People can be made aware of it. It's such a powerful social media. I think that's not very difficult.
For our Marathi viewers, Rajeshwari Godbhuleji is asking if you can state the name of the original Marathi book.
It is similar. It's a direct translation. Bharatiya itihasatil saha soneri pani.
Okay. You talked about Kolkata and Bihar. And today, if you look at it, where the Muslim community is the most violent is the one where they were converted from Buddhism to Muslim, whether it is Bengal, whether it is Bihar, whether it is J&K. But then the same boards are not so passive when it comes to Thailand, when it comes to Myanmar. And they even carry a weapon, whether they use it or not, I don't know about that, but I've seen monks carrying it. Why do you think it is so different everywhere?
So in the book itself, there are several Buddhist kings who did raise their weapons, who were violent. I mean, they indulged in wars. There was Mihir Gula, who is actually a hoon, who had, along with the other Indian subcontinent territory that he ruled, he also ruled some northwestern portions of India. So he believed in Buddhism, and he also believed in the Rudra Devta, which is Shiva. Kanishka also had this Mahayan Buddhism and Hinayan Buddhism, where Mahayan Buddhism did not strictly stick to what we popularly believe as Buddhism. Because I think if the Buddha existed in the times of Muslim invasions, he too might have changed his opinions or what he preached to a certain degree to suit the circumstances of that time. And they picked up weapons, they fought wars and everything. It is only the common Buddhists which did not pick up arms.
Why is it that the community that was most passive to get converted to Islam so quickly is the most violent one today? Is it just the preaching of the Abrahamic faith that has moved them so?
No, I think they just have political masters who protect them, and that is why they are so, without any fear of law or anything, they just go on a rampage. That's not to do with the fearlessness or anything. Any man, Hindu or Muslim, he is going to be afraid for his life. Since they are protected, they indulge in such things. Is my take on it.
Now, the stories of Gandhi's Ahimsa is pushed into the minds of all the public through our school textbooks. Now, somehow the Muslims and Christians are able to purge that thought out from the minds of their community children, which Hindus are finding it difficult to do. So, somehow the idea of Gandhi's Ahimsa sticks on. Can you think of a solution that we can do to get out of this mess?
Yeah, I think by teaching the right history, the not the distorted history, with the review of history, that certainly can be corrected, which I think many people are making that effort now. As you grow up, you read a lot more literature, you also get educated, then you also teach your children differently. All of us today have attended this Swatantryaveer Sawarkar's lecture. Swatantryaveer Sawarkar is gaining so much attention nowadays. That itself speaks for what you are wanting.
I believe that under Ranjit Singh, because he became so powerful, that there were a section of Muslims who did convert. I don't know about numbers. This is something I actually heard, that Ranjit Singh was in control of everything and the empire was Sikh. So many of the Muslims do not want to be at a disadvantage. Like when the Mughals are in power, then they are at an advantage. But when the Sikhs took over and they were in control, there were many who converted. Do you have any information about that or anything you could share?
The way I would interpret it is, I wouldn't call it a Sikh empire. It was a Hindu empire, and the king was Sikh. Sikh is not a separate religion.
I agree. Now, the other point, I'm sorry to interject, is because Sikhs have one very good thing about them, which we see even in recent times. They actually have a conversion ritual. Unlike Hindus, who you go to Arya Samaj, they have made up these things. Hindus actually have to be born Hindus. So that is the biggest disadvantage. Whereas a Hindu marries a Muslim, invariably, you know, even if the Hindu is a man, he is the one who ends up converting, you know what I mean? Whereas Sikhs have that ritual. So is there scope, you think, for Hinduism to become a little more organized and maybe have a set practice where the person doesn't even need to go to Arya Samaj or anything? What would you recommend?
See, it is no longer so strict. If a person, I have seen many others who simply live like the Hindus. Finally, Hinduism is just a way of life. So in fact, in Kerala, they have their own rule where you have to... Like you give a public notice, you give a notice in the newspapers that henceforth I have converted to Hinduism or Christianity or whatever. It is just a public declaration which you give a notice in the newspapers.
Actually, Vaishali, what I wanted to ask is, some years ago, you might recall Yogi Adityanath, who he was not CM at the time. He was not UP CM. He was MP. At the time, he had given a talk about how we should actually create a separate caste when you convert. He actually said that in a public meeting. Do you think there's scope in that idea? What do you think?
See, Swami Vivekananda also had said the same thing, because this question was posed that, okay, if they reconvert, and that time, at the times of Swami Vivekananda, the caste system must have been still very rigid. So he was asked then, which caste will they belong to? So he said that can be just another caste, because there are already so many castes besides the main four castes. There are already so many subcastes. So that can just be another subcaste and they can be accepted back. But I don't, today I think casteism is so irrelevant in our society, or at least in the urban centers of society, that accepting them back and forming another caste also will be unnecessary. Perhaps it still has some importance in the villages, the rural areas.
So my question is that, see, we have discussed about reconversion and different methods of reconversion. Do you think this cultural exchange can, over the generations, play a role in this?
It certainly can. And some of your ideas, like little children play with the kitchen utensils and house, or in Marathi we call it Bhatukli. So if some rituals or something can be included, which can be developed, toys can be developed to do aarti of a Bhagwan, or more than the ritualistic part, maybe something to teach something about the philosophical part, that would even be more desirable. And through educative toys like that, it could pick up.
So in Muslims, there is a caste like Pathan, Sheikh, Sharif, Sayyid, etc. And I have seen that there is not much intercaste marriage in them as well. And there is a very good sexual classification of the society. Now, within Christians as well, I have seen something like this, where in Kerala there are something called Nanaya Christians, who were the earlier ones who had come here. So they also have different priests for them, and they look at the other Christians as third-rate Christians. Same thing with that is happening in Catholics as well in Kerala. So my question is, within their community, they see this caste thing as a strength. However, in the Hindu community, this caste is considered as a bad thing. Now, there is a concern here that that it is bad in Hindu is more so published by the Western media, which makes it something unique. For example, let me explain. Suppose I have a company, and I have another company who is a competitor of me. Now, if the competitor is telling some bad practices about me, he's publishing that, okay, there are some bad practices. Actually, if there is a bad practice in my company and it is affecting me badly, he wouldn't tell me that, yeah, there is a bad practice, right? So my concern here is that the caste system in Muslims and Christians is strengthening them, whereas the caste system in, and the same thing, the marriage does not happen, intercaste marriage doesn't happen. How is it that the caste system in Hindus become bad? I'm not saying it's good or bad. I'm just keeping an argument with a comparison in what is happening. So if you can have any take, and there is much less media coverage on these kind of things, but in case you have had any friends who are from Muslims and Christians, you might have noticed this. Dhanyavaad.
I have many friends, Muslim friends and Christian friends, but I haven't studied that. But coming back to the book, I can tell you what is being said about the caste system in Hinduism. Like, why did it come about? So after the invasions of the Huns, and when the total nation was like in fatigue, it was all the leaders, all of the country thought of, you know, to quickly come out of the losses out of war times, they decided to strengthen the caste system. And which must have served its purpose at that time, because it involved division of labor. Somebody born in that caste followed that same profession, so he could plan for a longer time. So division of labor, the skills that a particular community had, or the economy of it also. So in that sense, the caste system was helpful to the Hindu society as well. But as soon as it lost its relevance, it should have been discarded, is what Sawarkar says, which I agree with.
I just want to ask you a small question. Like, Sawarkar said that to be a Hindu, you need to consider this land as your Janmabhoomi and your Bhoomibhoomi. Right? And at the same time, he supported, you know, he said it is important to do Shuddhi and conversions. So according to his perspective, like, what is his stand for the non-Hindus, or say Muslim or Christians, who have not converted but consider themselves as Swadeshi?
You're talking about Sawarkar's Hindutva, where he defines a Hindu whose holy land and fatherland are both within the geographical concerns of this nation. Is that right?
Yes.
And Yeah, what he said is justified, because I see many Muslims who will support a Muslim outside of India rather than support support India. He'll support somebody outside of India only because he's a Muslim. So this is where Sawarkar ji is justified in saying what he did. Or even Christians, at the time of some Christians, I will not say some all Muslims or all Christians, but some Christians, when that mulakkal or something, that the rape case of the nun, and then they just said, no, the Pope has declared him not guilty. So who's the Pope to decide something in India? So, but there, many Christians too will agree with it, that yes, India will follow its own legal procedure to decide whether he was guilty or not guilty. And the Pope shouldn't interfere with anything that's happening here. With the religious matters, they can, but not civil social order, law and order situation, or some atrocities against women or something like that, the Pope cannot interfere. So many Christians too had this belief. So in that sense, they've already accepted this as a fatherland and a holy land. So I don't, where he states that, okay, if you side with the Pope or you side with the Khalifa instead of India, when the confrontation happens, then that is not correct. And that is why Sawarkar is justified.